Thank you, sir. I'm going on mute and I'm disabling my camera.
Thank you. Good afternoon to the two speakers of the day, Mr. Ajay Sahni and Mr. Naushir Kaka, and also all the viewers from all over India and globally. Today, there is a lot of buzz in the industry about artificial intelligence and also open digital public platforms. So in this session, we are going to see the confluence of these two strong ideas and strong currents that are going on. The Ministry of, let me first introduce myself. I'm J. Satyanarayana. I was a career civil servant for about 40 years, and I worked as Secretary Government of India, the Ministry of Electronics and IT, and also as chairman of UIDAI or Aadhaar. I was also chairing the group on National Digital Health Blueprint last year, which was announced by the Honorable Prime Minister of India on 15th of August this year. In addition, I am chief advisor to the World Economic Forum currently. So with that brief introduction, let me say a few words about the topic of the day. The Ministry of the Electronics and IT has taken up a good number of initiatives in the last few years. To mention a few of them, the trillion-dollar economy is one of the major reports that they have done, and exploring what all can be done to boost the IT and electronics sector to $1 trillion size in India. In addition, other initiatives like national open digital ecosystems and public digital platforms like UPI and GSTN, they have taken up all these initiatives in the recent past. And also, the Niti Aayog has released a strategy paper on artificial intelligence and also ethics in AI jointly with the World Economic Forum. So the discussion today will center around these two themes, the confluence of these two themes, that is how data will be drawn from the public digital platforms to power the AI solutions. We have very good speakers today who have rich experience in their respective areas. I have the pleasure of introducing both of them initially. Mr. Ajay Sahni, whom of course I don't have to introduce too long, because he has been quite popular as Secretary Government of India in the Ministry of Electronics and IT. He has been a civil servant for over 35 years, mostly in the IT, in the public sector. Among his achievements, if we have to say go way back, there were several achievements, but importantly, the establishment of the Indian Institute of Information Technology at Hyderabad. And also, of late, the kind of interest he has been taking in driving the Digital India program and also the Make in India program, the electronics manufacturing in the country. And he is a very strong proponent of open systems and public digital platforms. The second speaker we have is Mr. Naushir Kaka. He's a senior partner at McKinsey, leader of the McKinsey's analytics practice. He also co-leads the technology, media, and telecom practices within McKinsey. And like Mr. Ajay Sahni, he is also behind one of the great institutions that came up in Hyderabad, that is Indian School of Business at Hyderabad. So with these few words of introduction, let me just jump in with a few questions to be addressed by Mr. Ajay Sahni initially. So Ajay, yourself and the ministry have been advocating the need for India to establish a set of public digital platforms for providing better services to the citizens of this country, and also to unlock the economic potential of the public digital platforms, which lead to the trillion dollar economy that you have earlier envisioned. So what is the concept of a public digital platform, and what are the sectors where you are planning to build these or promote these public digital platforms, and what kind of major characteristics these platforms have? Can you please tell the viewers about that?
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the introduction and also for the questions. The digital platforms actually have been a dominant force in across the globe now for about 20 years. And these have come in with the World Wide Web, and basically they leverage the characteristics of the compute and sharing of information being almost free, being perfect replicas of, once a data is there and a digital copy is almost perfect, and instant communication. So when they get applied to a particular domain, they tend to actually bring everyone onto one leading platform. So we have seen this happen in case of social media platforms. And lately, we have also seen it happen in almost nationwide platforms. The concept of public digital platforms is something which is actually a hallmark of India. And in India, we have always felt that such a platform which creates immense amount of value needs to be not left only to the private sector to create. There are certain things that governments do very well. And when governments actually try to bring in a digital platform with the unifying a particular domain, I think we are doing it as a public good and something which would then be available to everyone. And these, many a time, these also involve certain authorities or powers that governments uniquely have. For instance, the Aadhaar platform, the national ID is designed as not just a core database. It's designed as an online identity. It's designed as an identity. It's moving away from a system. We used to do a large number of projects and we used to do a beautiful system. Now this one is moving towards being an ecosystem. It is not just a central database. It's also authorized service providers, authorized service agencies, authorized user agencies, registrars, and many, many more people who actually make up the entire ecosystem. And then each one of them adds immense amount of value. Similarly, we have seen platforms come up like the UPI, Unified Payments Interface, which has taken the conventional banking, which had a core banking solution implemented, and actually put a layer on top, which unified the huge domain of banking across this massive country and enabled digital payment service providers to build on top of the core banking system, the conventional banking system, but all of banking in one place and brought together in such a way that new solutions can be mounted right on top. Similar work is done in case of unification of taxation system by the GSTN platform. So GSTN is not just taxation system. There's also an underlying digital platform which actually makes it come alive, which brings in the central government, the state governments, and various implementers, all the taxpayers, into one large platform which caters to all their requirements. Similarly, the government e-marketplace, the GEM platform, has brought together buyers from across the governments, federal or provincial governments, along with suppliers from across the length and breadth of the country. So it's when it happens as a public good, it has something magical. We are currently, sir, you are aware, you have guided that effort. Each of these digital platforms follow the India Enterprise Architecture, the Agile India Enterprise Architecture, which again is currently under revision and will come up soon with a new avatar. Also, these follow the Open API policy and Open API guidelines issued by the Government of India. So it is by drawing open APIs from existing projects that we are able to create this unifying platform. It is not a uniform thing that runs across the country. It is unifying in character. So a large number of projects that might have happened in a particular domain, the platform, the national platform, acts as a unifying force. It ensures that data resources, which were hitherto being used primarily to deliver services for which the original project was envisaged, those resources can be shared across projects, and they can be shared beyond those projects as well. So they add value. Each project benefits from having access to data from other projects. And when they are put together in a structured manner, we can create opportunities to build new solutions on top of that. That primarily is the concept of the public digital platform, sir. And we are trying to move forward with making this happen, making it come alive in all the important domains in the economy, starting with healthcare, where such a platform is already not just announced, but it is already rolled out in a pilot phase in 6 union territories. The education domain, the agriculture domain, the social justice domain, possibly the criminal justice and, the entire criminal justice investigation and criminal justice domain, and many, many more, which we are now currently working on. And under your guidance, many of these are also taking shape.
Thank you, Ajay, for that quick but very precise idea about public digital platform. Just to recap, that you emphasize the unifying nature of the platform, so, and also unity in diversity, building on top of the existing, and openness, open APIs, and also a combination of all this is going to unlock the huge potential that the data, which is currently hidden under the surface, surely you are unlocking all that to help the economy, digital economy. Thank you very much, Ajay. We'll come back to the how part of it a little later. Yes, let me go to Noshir at this point and request him to address another area of, while Ajay spoke about, the huge potential that exist in this digital economy. And we have also been associated with a number of studies in the last few years, including the $1 trillion economy report. So what is the, what opportunity, size of the opportunity available in the space of AI and, data, number one. And also, what are the kind of major sectors in which this potential exists to be tapped more easily than the others? And secondly, what are the key building blocks? Okay, if there is X size, what are the steps required for us to take as a country? Can you please throw some light on these areas? Noshir, over to you.
Thank you. Yes. Firstly, thank you, both JS and Ajay. It is truly a pleasure to share the stage with you. Two people who have done so much for promoting technology and its use in India. To answer your question very specifically, if you look at our Prime Minister's aspiration of reaching a $5 trillion economy by 2025, we think that what Ajay described as the combination of AI plus data can actually deliver 10% of that. 10% of $500 billion in 4.5 years is larger than our tech services industry has taken over the last 30 years to create. That is the potential in front of us. It doesn't only come from the technology sector. As you rightly said, it comes from actually enabling the data, the infrastructure, the technology layer, and the talent pool in various sectors. And it's very unique to India. So let me describe how that 500 billion breaks down. So if you look at that, there is almost no sector that doesn't get touched by that opportunity. But India is perhaps the most unique country or the only country in the world where you could say the opportunity from AI in agriculture is as large as it is in banking. There's no other country possibly in the world where you would say that. We believe both banking and agriculture could be between $60 to $80 billion each, right? I mean, that is huge. Of course, consumer is also there, another industry that you asked me to refer to or talk about. But also the thrust towards green energy, smart energy. So the entire energy industrial sector is another huge opportunity to enable this. Now, how did this come about with what Ajay described as the public digital platforms? So if you look at some of the recommendations that we've also made, and we'll touch upon that later. But if you look at, let's say, agriculture and doubling farmers' income, it requires a combination of those data sets, the land records, the soil health cards, weather data, mandi data, and many, many other forms of data. Right? When you bring that data together, you can actually make predictions far better. For example, crop failure predictions. Today, we can predict the yield of a crop within 6 weeks of its planting. And within 1 week of its planting, we can actually predict how much yield will actually generate simply from having those data sets. So taking advantage of that to improve the yield of farmers or ensure farmers when we know that there's actually likely to be a failure in the crop is a huge step forward in doubling our farmers' income. That's one example. The second I'll refer to is what Ajay talked about, our health stack or the healthcare industry. For example, today, it's not just doctors and patients that are going on to telemedicine, but the doctor's interaction with just about anyone, pharmaceutical representations, hospitals to doctors, patients amongst patients, all of that is enabled virtually. The delivery of drugs, the prediction of how much you will need per area, all of that is possible actually with this data. To come to your second, so as we look at it, $500 billion, 10% of the Prime Minister's aspiration, one area in 4.5 years. That's the opportunity in front of us. Second, to answer your question, what would it take for us to get there? It takes many, many things, but I'll just highlight four. The first is, it takes a very clear understanding of where value exists. If you compile data only for the sake of compiling data, you typically don't get anywhere. But if you compile data and technology and people behind a objective function, which is I want to improve farmer yields, I want to actually provide loans or underwrite loans to MSMEs. If you start value back in each of our ministries, profiling the data, profiling the opportunity, which I think the government has done very well, that's the first step. Second, talent. Actually, most of the fault lines in AI doesn't lie in hardware, it lies in software. And software is not the software that you and I are used to, not the code only, it is actually the human talent. We have the potential to become the largest AI talent engine in the world. And we should take advantage of that because of our great education system that has allowed for us to focus on maths and science. Third is data and technology. Ajay already spoke about that, but I won't deliver that. The last one, which is very important, is change management and execution. To enable that, we think you actually need speed. 3 months in this COVID time is equal to 3 years any other time. And speed of execution is absolutely critical to getting it done. As we've studied countries around the world, the ones that have got it right are the ones, number one, that have profiled the value, that have built their talent pool, that have enabled their data and technology layer, and added on top of that a change management and execution engine that gets it done. These are the five things in mind.
Thank you, Roshir. Really, it's a very attractive proposition you have made for data plus AI. And I interpret this as data is the new oil, as they say. So we have to find out where the oil wells are. We must explore there. We have already done a good bit of that. And how to drill and how to tap that oil is really the in front of us right now. So let me go back to Ajay with another set of questions. Ajay, the success of what the public digital platforms offer, it depends on creating the necessary architectures and standards. And also, in a country like India, with the center states having their own responsibilities and divided clearly, and a lot of role being played by private sector along with public sector. So data as such cannot be in a centralized manner. It cannot be managed in a centralized manner. So federated architectures are being talked about. One is having the data, whether it is unified or whether it is federated. Second is having access to that data in a seamless manner. So that is also a kind of a challenge if we have to realize this big dream that we have in front of us. So how do you think that access can be authorized to the innovators and also to the industry and to public sector as well? And also simultaneously complying with all the regulations that are available today. So one is, what kind of architectural initiatives are you taking? And secondly, how do you enable access in a way that innovators would be feeling comfortable with?
When we go ahead with building the platforms, I think we have to accomplish it in two stages, and some of them can overlap as well. But first, we have to bring together a large number of existing projects that have been implemented. Now, in a federal polity like India, I think already we have the advantage that many of the nationwide projects have been implemented sort of joining up the central effort and the state government's efforts. For instance, projects that look after mother and child healthcare. Or Rashtriya Bal Suraksha, Bal Swasthya Karyakram. So these are implemented both at the federal level and they are guided by the federal level, and all the state governments have participated. So first thing is, what is the architecture that will actually unify or help bring these projects together? And how do you also make sure that the concerns of all the stakeholders are taken care of? So we have to build privacy by design. It's extremely important that we take care of the personal data privacy. We take care of, protect the assets which are very important to all of us. And we are holding them in trust for the citizens. And, basically we are, as a public institution, we are holding them in trust. We have to ensure that security is built in by design. We have to also ensure, I think this has become very clear over the past few years, that it is not a unified or a consolidated data set that's necessary. In fact, our constitution decides or guides us as to what subject is to be steered at what level. And the digital technologies help us to keep the data sets federated and yet accomplish tremendous value or derive tremendous value by having mechanisms of unifying them in towards a particular purpose. So so we have to follow the architecture, as I had mentioned earlier, the India Enterprise Architecture and the digital service standards come in extremely handy. We use open APIs. Once again, we have both policy and guidelines to help us in that. And we have to build value for every stakeholder. I really compliment Noshir for, again, drawing attention to the extraordinary value of making sure that every stakeholder gets value out of what we are doing. And the project owners get value because they get access to a large amount of data of other projects. And every stakeholder in an education project platform, for instance, the student should have a single sign-on, a school should have a single sign-on, and many other content providers who can provide value-added services can also have a single sign-on. So the entire platform has to be designed with that in mind. And the second stage is to prepare it for others beyond the government to actually make full use of that, but in a responsible manner. So the theme of our 5-day conference is Responsible AI for Social Empowerment. And this is precisely what a public digital platform sets out to do. We on one side, we bring or consolidate it into an India-wide platform and then create opportunities for data analytics, create opportunities for geospatial technologies, create opportunities for blockchain to be used where it is relevant, create opportunities for AR and VR to be deployed where it is relevant, create opportunities for natural language processing to be deployed at a nationwide scale. So then we have an opportunity to create structured opportunities for entities that come in from outside to actually build value on top of this nationwide stack, whether it is a health stack or an education stack or an agriculture stack or a criminal justice stack. People will have an opportunity. The startups will get that opportunity. Established companies will get that opportunity. And we can actually end up, because we have such a huge base to build on, we can end up creating products and services which can be the finest across the globe. So this is the dream with which we are moving forward with these public digital platforms.
Thank you, Ajay. And there are a couple of questions. We'll address them towards the end, the chat from Shashi and Debashish. So I have one more round, quick round with the two speakers, which is going to Noshir again. So you have mentioned about a very huge opportunity that exists in the space of data and AI. So what are the kind of high-level decisions required to realize this kind of a dream and vision? And what is the role of a public-private cooperation in this? And do you envisage any national-level institutional framework to really exploit this in a systematic and timely fashion? Can you throw some light on the, how-to part of it? Noshir.
Thank you, Jaya. So I think I would have 6 suggestions or ideas, to be honest. I'll elaborate three of them, and one of them is the point you made last. I think there absolutely needs to be an institutional framework. We have suggested that we consider launching, and maybe this today is an example of that, launching a national program for AI. We think this opportunity is big enough to justify that. There's very few opportunities that can be worth as much as this one is. We think certain structures are absolutely required to be put in place. For example, a national data office, along with the public digital platforms that Ajay talked about. These are absolutely essential things to do. And we've seen a lot of success from doing that. The second one I would recommend is nothing happens without data. And you are rightly mentioned that data is the new oil. There's one difference, JS, which is data can be reused. And that's actually the power. Oil can't be reused, but data can be reused multiple times. So we see 10, at least 10, there probably are others that we haven't got right. We see 10 data sets of national importance. Land records being one, healthcare data being another, satellite data being a third. We must find a way, both with public and private partnership, to your second point of the question, because no one has access to all the data. But with public and private partnerships, if we can come together under the framework of what Ajay has suggested, we can actually put 10 or 12 of these national data sets of strategic importance together. What will that allow? It will allow the vast body of stakeholders, whether they are the government entities, state level, central level, NGOs, private sector, startup, large company, they will allow these companies and these entities to actually work off that data and build applications and build value-based offerings off that data. So that's my second suggestion or recommendation, which is at least 10 data sets of national importance. And my third suggestion would be take the first step, which is nothing, you know, this is a long journey, but every journey starts with the first step. The first step could be, as you have done in healthcare, get the public and private partners together. Start with where is their value? Do this by each ministry, perhaps. And you probably have done it for quite a few ministries already. What are the 10 use cases or domains that constitute the greatest value? Conduct a series of sessions to actually spur that idea, spur that thinking, spur that innovation, and go forward. Of course, I will hasten to add that my job is the easiest, which is I provide the ideas or the advice. And of course, it's left to, you know, difficult roles are left to people like Ajay and others to actually try to make sense of it and implement it. But if we did these three things, it would make a huge difference to this country on what I fundamentally believe is one of our greatest opportunities for this generation to exploit, both economically and socially.
Thank you, Noshir. Let me also add that dreaming is also not a simple job. Dreaming, about a country and its vision and what needs to be realized and how is also not an easy task. Of course, implementation definitely is a bigger task, but dreaming is also not a trivial task, I must say. I must compliment you and thank you for that. Let me go back to Ajay and to the last question, which is to what is the kind of social benefits that are likely to come out of this, combination of data and AI, and especially from the viewers, we have a couple of questions, mainly on the, what is the status of the public digital platform on agriculture? And also, is there any idea on the chemical industry to create any platform for the chemical industry? And lastly, how does it reach, the last mile? How do you reach the farmer, who maybe, in a remote area may not be so much digitally literate? So how do you want to address this? So could you please throw some light on this?
Sir, first of all, I'd like to address your first question of what are the societal benefits. I would like to say something very emphatically, and this is what comes to us from our Honorable Prime Minister and from our Honorable Minister, that AI in India must be inclusive. The benefits must reach the last man in the queue. Our strength in use of AI will be not in only enriching some, but in making life easier, in improving the ease of living, in improving the ease of doing business for everyone. And we must reach those who are disadvantaged. Now, this can be done in many, many ways. The very first way that public digital platforms actually bring this to us is that it is not the government alone which then is trying to provide services to the citizens. We are actually moving into it as Team India. The government doing what it does best and people outside the government getting an opportunity to add tremendous amount of value, to bring in new services, to bring in new products, and to do it in a truly competitive manner and try to tap the markets even at the bottom of the pyramid. So this is something which will truly bring huge benefits to everyone. A single sign-on and with all of India, all of the farmers, all of the students, all of the healthcare seekers being on a platform makes it a humongous asset, which can actually be leveraged by Team India to actually improve the services like never before. And for instance, the very first thing that needs to be done, as Professor Raj Reddy also pointed out last evening, is language. For the first time, use of AI might be able to bring us real-time speech-to-speech conversation, speech-to-speech communication between someone in India who knows only Bengali and someone else in India who knows only Malayalam. You know, centuries of barriers across languages can suddenly be broken by use of AI, by use of technology. The access to information, access to knowledge, access to education, access to skills, access to services in healthcare, education, and agriculture. These are one set that one is able to enable through this kind of a public digital platform. On the other side is also access to livelihoods, access to markets, access to, you know, aspirations where someone can aspire to do something well beyond what they would have been able to do in the absence of such digital enablement. So we see it as a huge opportunity for India, and an opportunity which we must tap, keeping the last man in the queue in mind when we design and roll out these systems.
Would you like to touch upon the agri sector status and chemical industry, anything? And, you know,
sir, agriculture, I think a blueprint, or as we characterize it, sir, it will be a green print. I think that is at an advanced stage. Already a farmer's database has been put together very nicely. But unifying things around a farm record and then building the entire, large platform around that concept, I think that's something that will come in through this, the nationwide blueprint, sir. And I think we should see this getting unveiled in this quarter itself, hopefully in the earlier part of the quarter. On the chemical industry, I'm not quite certain about chemical industry separately, but we do have some work going on in the industry sector. MSME is actually leading that effort currently, but we are yet to sort of give it the shape of an entire nationwide digital platform. There's work to be done in that direction. And as I mentioned, sir, with the BharatNet, with the fiber going to 6 lakh villages, all our villages within 1,000 days from 15th of August, work on which has already started. I think not just the connectivity over mobile, but connectivity through the fiber links also will reach more and more places now. And at any point of time, sir, making sure that everyone has access remains a very, very high priority with the Government of India. We work closely in that with the telecom departments.
Thank you, Ajay, for that very good overview. So let me conclude and summarize the session. I thank both the speakers for educating us on these two exciting areas. So what transpires is that the power of public digital platform is immense, and it's a India specific kind of a concept which could amount to about $500 billion if it is properly and systematically exploited. And also it is one key takeaway is also the theme of this conference, which is responsible AI, so that the access to the data that is so valuable, much more than its face value, 10 times more than its face value. So the responsibility in accessing and utilizing and deploying through AI is very important, which is also the theme of this conference. It's one more point. And on the implementation side, since the job is huge and gigantic, so the first steps would involve identifying 10 major national data sets and creating them in a federated manner, protecting the privacy of the individuals wherever individual data is involved, and also taking up 10 national flagship programs in this direction is a huge movement forward. And end of the day, it should be an inclusive national program for the on AI and data. And Team India, I wish Team India all the best in this great initiative. And I hope that this will be also realized substantially through a public-private partnership, in a very systematic and quick manner, so that we don't lose the time on this opportunity. So I thank both the speakers for their excellent contribution to this discussion. And I compliment the METI once again for putting together such a major international event like this. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, not just for your steering this session, but also steering the broader concept of public digital platforms and your personal guidance that we have received in healthcare, in education. We are receiving that in agriculture and in many other domains. Thanks a lot, and thanks also to Nosheer for participating in this wonderful session.
Thank you very much, Ajay. Nosheer, thank you. All the best.
Bye-bye.